Hello, my name is Andrei Zinovyev. I'm a researcher at Institut Curie. I'm very proud to open this course with such impressive list of speakers. And my mission here is to provide an introductory and inspiring lecture on the promises of artificial intelligence in cancer systems biology. So first of all, I would like to introduce our group at Institut Curie with the name Computational Systems Biology of Cancer. So the title of this conference is not a random choice, because the idea of this course was born inside our group and then supported by many people. In our group, we published a book, which is also called Computational Systems Biology of Cancer, which was supposed to be, is supposed to be a textbook in the field. Also, after the first version of the course, we there was another book published with this title. So please, this might be useful material for you. So in our group, we follow three, more or less three research directions: knowledge maps, creating, formalizing biological knowledge in the form of maps, mathematical modeling, and multi-omics data analysis. So all these three directions we do for almost 15 years now. And since a few years, they have a huge impact from the field of machine learning and artificial intelligence. So this is why the focus of the course this year on the role of artificial intelligence in systems biology. So let me start from claiming that we are facing happy marriage between artificial intelligence and systems biology, and like in any couple, in any marriage, it's important to understand who promises what to whom, and even more importantly probably is what will be the common dreams of the couple. So money, I mean some initial capital doesn't harm any marriage and only support it. So from systems biology side, I think this capital consists in providing big data, which are collected in systems biology in the form of formalized knowledge. So knowledge about molecular mechanisms collected in pathway databases and different types of interaction networks. Another source of big data from systems biology are rich collection of omics data set, which is available today, and also high throughput imaging, another important source of information generated. From the side of artificial intelligence, well, the initial capital consists in quite developed AI infrastructure and a rich set of methods, which potentially can be applicable to the questions of systems biology. And this is something we are going to discuss in the next hour. So what are the, what can be the common dreams of this couple? I think if you try to formulate it, I think the common dream can be creation of big models of biological systems and big predictive models such that we can predict potentially any perturbation applied to a biological system at the level of a cell, tissue, organ, or the whole organism. So this triangle, big compute, big models, big data, today assume to be hallmarks of the success and connected enthusiasm of application of machine learning and artificial intelligence in many different fields. So this couple potentially has all chances to be happy. So this marriage between systems biology and artificial intelligence was announced last year at the International Conference on Systems Biology in Okinawa by the father of systems biology, Hiroaki Kitano, and his keynote talk. And one of the suggestions of this talk was that it's a prediction that in some near future, a combination of systems biology approach with artificial intelligence supported by the methodology of artificial intelligence will be able to win a Nobel Prize in physiology and medicine. So we can take this prediction seriously or not, but there was quite a number of interesting elements in this discussion. In particular, the Kitana suggested that artificial intelligence based method can boost research in biology in general, but in systems biology in particular, also with avoiding larger human expert bias existing in the field and reducing the role of chance in biological discoveries by applying massive search and verification of hypothesis space, which accordingly to him can be organized following the success of this AlphaGo Zero project, where just given some space of possibilities to AI system play against each other and in such way kind of find the best strategy of playing. So similarly, Kitana suggests that in biological research, we can kind of systematically use the role of simulation, where one artificial intelligence system would simulate the data produced from different states of biological systems. Then another artificial intelligence system would systematically, automatically interpret this data and formulate hypotheses and suggest new experiments, which can be also executed in this virtual environment. Of course, it doesn't exclude the role of experimental science, but the idea that we can rely more and more on simulations. So we will see how successful will be this prediction. So a bit of the history of the couple. Both terms are not that young. Systems biology term was coined in 1968 and artificial intelligence in 1956. There is already quite a bit of history for both, and there were big ups and downs in the expectations for these approaches, like for any technological innovations. What is interesting to notice is that from the very beginning in both fields, both fields were kind of formulated in a dual way. So part of the field, both in systems biology and artificial intelligence, had in mind the formalization of knowledge and the formalization of concept in such a way that it can be manipulated by a computer. And another part of both fields was relying more on analysis of large amounts of data and learning from the data. So this is a kind of similarity between two fields. Now let us say few words about the distinction between machine learning and artificial intelligence. Again, this distinction can be converted into a philosophical dispute quite easily, but I think in the professional community, there is a kind of established agreement, which is also approximation of the reality, of course, that machine learning is one particular approach inside the artificial intelligence field. And within machine learning, there are more or less simpler or complex approaches. And one of the most exciting things nowadays are happening in application of so-called neural artificial intelligence connected to this notion of deep learning. So if you look at the focus of artificial intelligence in the last decades, we see that it shifts somehow from artificial intelligence not connected to machine learning and even data analysis towards the application of this deep learning techniques. If you look at the systems biology, we can see that the interest of systems biology also somehow shifts in more or less parallel direction. which is a good sign for the couple, because as you know, members of the couple in the marriage, they should look in the same direction. So there is no any doubt that machine learning became part of biological research, and biology in turn became the flavor of data science today, and both synergizing, and the role of machine learning in helping analyzing biological data is undeniable, and there are many successes connected to this. So here I listed the typical applications of machine learning in biological data analysis. So of course, machine learning helps visualizing multidimensional data sets, reduce their complexity, integrate the data from different sources, but also from different levels of description of biological systems. These, in terms of scientific problems, this helps in cancer field, for example, to stratify patients into molecular subtypes. It also, this is a major role of machine learning, is a prediction of survival, best treatment, drug effect. And more recently, machine learning was very promising in analysis of imaging data and clinical health records. So all these are applications of machine learning for which machine learning is designed for. So this is why the success and usefulness of this of AI ML in these applications is cannot be denied today. However, when we talk about promises of artificial intelligence, at least myself, I think that we can talk about one step further. The artificial intelligence as a field might promise us a little bit more. It can promise us to formulate new problems in biological research and new questions, and maybe help solving these new problems. So we talk about promises of artificial intelligence in systems biology and in biology. I would like to remind you the story of a Google cat, which was quite famous a few years ago. So this story is about a computational experiment which was made by some teams in Google, in which millions of YouTube videos were analyzed by unsupervised or kind of self-supervised algorithm without labeling objects in these videos. And after watching millions and millions of videos, in the end, it was clear that this unsupervised neural network, in some sense, discovered the concept of a cat in these videos. So, systematically, it could kind of by itself label certain fragments of the video as a cat face. It was not only cat face which was discovered as a concept, because there was a group of neurons which was responsible in the end for the concept of a human body or human face also. But well, this can be kind of a symbol of these expectations from artificial intelligence, that even without explicit and expert-based labeling of the data, this massive observation of the data produced in biological research might help find the patterns which would be not evident for human mind. And maybe these patterns would correspond to the concepts that we are missing today in biological research. Also, part of the expectations is connected to that artificial intelligence can help us to unravel biological complexity, for example, at the level of gene regulation. In the end, all this might hint on maybe on some missing fundamental principles of biological systems, which we are eager to find. Maybe these principles will be based on some optimality criterion, which we cannot formulate for the moment. So all this in the end might lead us to better understanding of evolution, and in our field, cancer biology. So in the end of my talk, I will give examples of some projects where, at my point of view, it's my personal visions of things, some interesting things are happening, and maybe we have some hints of these promises of artificial intelligence. So let me start from mentioning something that we do for a long time in our group. It's logical modeling in systems biology of cancer. We were one of the first group who started to apply this logical modeling for cancer, for modeling cancer-related mechanisms, like in this paper devoted to self-fate decisions in response to this receptor engagement, or more recent paper on modeling invasion and migration. So for us, this logical modeling is one of the basic tool, and we had a lot of discussions around it, and this tool can be viewed from two different angles. So one angle is to consider it as an approximation of chemical kinetics in the case of stepwise, kinetic laws. But I think it's even more productive to consider this modeling as an automated logical reasoning in molecular biology. Moreover, I mean, as you know, the first systems in artificial intelligence, we are also based on logical modeling. So when we constructed our first logical models, it was really like constructing the first expert systems in AI by talking with experts and formalizing their knowledge in the form of logical rules, also by reading literature and so on. So from the very beginning, of course, it was very important for us to connect these results of this modeling with the data, with observations, and we suggested interpretation of the results of this simulation as predicting probabilities of certain phenotypes. I'm not going to talk in details about this, but I would like to mention how this type of activity is transforming in our group by mentioning one project in which we start from the structure of let's say knowledge graph, of the graph of interactions, but then we look in the geometrical, we try to characterize the geometrical structure of, for example, in this case, is of a single cell data set, from which we extract a set of branching trajectories using state-of-the-art tools designed for this. And then for us, this set of trajectories serves as a set of constraints for possible dynamics of Boolean dynamics, of possible dynamical models. So for example, I mean, there are different types of constraints that we can extract from this set of trajectories. So for example, this is an example of non-reachability constraint between state C and D, meaning that after self-fate division has happened, so after the bifurcation has happened, there is no possibility to have a pass in the state transition graph of a Boolean model from state C to D. And we have a set of other similar constraints. And quite apparently, we can solve them using answer set programming. And in the end, we can enumerate a set of all possible Boolean models which are compatible with this particular single cell data sets. So if our set of trajectories is rich enough, it can reduce the number of all possible Boolean models from many millions, like you see in this graph, to by applying all types of constraints to 1,000 models. So of course, 1,000 and not one single model yet. So what you do with this, and just quite similarly to many ideas in machine learning, we model all of them, and they give an ensemble-based prediction of what is possible to happen given all uncertainties that we cannot totally fix given the data set that we haven't had. So this is just, for me, it's an example of evolution of a systems biology approach towards a more kind of intensive use of massive data sets. So also when we look in the field of systems biology, we see that more and more frequently biological networks or molecular mechanisms described in the form of, for example, ordinary differential equations serve not for, let's say, pure mechanistical modeling, but for sort of a hybrid approach in which a set of parameters of equations are trained using massive omics data sets, like in this quite famous study in which a pan-cancer pathway model containing 2,600 reactions, more than 1,000 chemical species and 4,000 parameters. It was trained for the data from Cancer Cell Line Encyclopedia to predict the effect of the different mutations. And in the end, so this trained model, which was, by the way, trained by the algorithms, when you look at them, you realize that these are very efficient algorithms which are borrowed from the artificial intelligence field. So it's literally back error back propagation algorithm. So after training, this model is capable to predict sensitivity to certain drugs or drug combinations, which is more difficult to obtain through experimental measurements. Also, kind of at larger scale, there is this competition between, let us say, knowledge, expert knowledge-based approach to whole cell modeling and data-driven approach to whole cell modeling. So there are these two projects. One is inspired by that famous success of whole cell modeling of simplest bacteria. To extend this success to human whole cell modeling. I mean, this project is not finished yet, but there are some blueprints at least for this modeling. And in competition to this approach, I mean, it's interesting to see how more AI-based systems are constructed. So in this paper, for example, from Ibeker's group, there was a neural network, which was called visible neural network, because it is supposed to be some kind of explainable, is constructed from 2,500 subsystems, which are defined by themselves using a data-driven approach. And so the connections between subsystems are trained, the parameters of the connections are trained using deep learning. And in the end, it represents a data-based, deep learning-based model of eukaryotic cells, yeast cells in this case. So it is impossible not to mention that the really holy grail of systems biology with respect to application of machine learning techniques is single cell data sets. So this is really a revolution which happened several years ago in biology. And in terms of application of machine learning, it's important to realize that a single cell data set probably for the first time in biological research provide a really big data for molecular biology. Because before all our measurements were limited by availability of samples, it's relatively difficult to collect even a few hundred patient samples, for example, and analyze them comprehensively. It's still a challenge. But when you produce single cell, you can take a piece of tumor, decompose it into millions of, potentially millions of individual cells, which creates millions of possible states of a biological system in a given context. And this makes analysis of this kind of data much more interesting from the machine learning point of view. Just again, give you a source of inspiration. On the left, you see a physical view of zebrafish and a pictorial description of the process of the development of zebrafish. And on the right, you see the same process represented in the multidimensional space. So it's a projection from multidimensional space of single cell transcriptomic profiles. So again, maybe for the first time in biological research, the complexity of the data which is generated is somehow matching the complexity of the initial biological object, which is a big shift, which in turn requires more advanced methods for analyzing such data. So this inspiration, this can be scaled up really to very big goals. And currently we have several large-scale projects aiming at collecting at large, generating and collecting, systematizing at large scales, single-cell profiles of healthy cells, but also cells in a kind of disease state. It's first of all, it's a human cell atlas project. And in Europe, there is this initiative called Lifetime, which is coordinated, by the way, jointly by Institut Curie and Max Planck Institute for Molecular Medicine in Berlin. The aim of this project is to use a breakthrough single cell in imaging technologies in combination with artificial intelligence and personalized disease modeling, not only for predicting disease earlier, but also selecting the most effective therapies for individual patients. So it's a really big goal. And a few days ago, actually in Nature, there was this paper with a mental image of the data, which is supposed to generate it in this project, which is represented here. So, I mean, roughly speaking, it's a set of thousands and maybe millions of individual clinical trajectories representing a fate of a particular patient, such that you have a kind of this common this main trunk of a healthy aging of a person, but also from this trunk you might have different bifurcations into disease, different diseases. And it's important to understand, to appreciate the complexity of this picture. It's important to understand that each point on this trajectory is supposed to describe a state of the organism at a single cell level. So all organs, all tissues, and potentially all types of cells in the human organism participate in forming this trajectory. So this is a very ambitious project combining efforts of many research centers in Europe. And the role of artificial intelligence and machine learning based methods is of course central and pivotal in this project. Again, if you talk about single cell, it's not possible not to mention a recent invention in this field, which is called RNA velocity. It creates also a small revolution by itself in the field of systems biology. I remind you that RNA velocity is a method which allows to predict what will happen with the transcriptome of individual cell in some near future, for example, in few hours from the moment of observation. This is done by observing a balance between the amount of spliced and unspliced mRNAs in the cell. And in the end, conceptually, you can characterize each cell not only by a position in multidimensional transcriptomic space, for example, but also by the first derivative of the trajectory which it will follow in the future. So, so which means, so for example, on the right, you see a snapshot of RNA velocity vectors for Ewing sarcoma cell line in the PCA space. And it represents a progression of cells through the cell cycle, because all the cells in this data set, they are actively cycling cells. So potentially from this picture, it must be possible to reconstruct many features of dynamics of the most important process in the cell, which means cell cycle. And you can go beyond, you can study more complicated processes. So you can, for example, in this is a snapshot of a lineage commitment in pancreatic and carinogenesis. And here you have a set of proliferating progenitor cells, then they, at some point, they stop proliferation and start to commit into different cellular fates. So, let's say from the mathematical point of view, now if you have these two vectors for many cells, you can start approximating this function f, which which describes the right hand side of the most basic, most fundamental equations for the dynamic of the biological system. And this is quite in contrast to what we, let us say, did in the last years when we tried to reverse engineer in biological systems. On many occasions, we tried to solve this equation. But I mean, you can understand that this equation with the derivative is much closer to what we want to obtain. So what is this F? I mean, in the beginning, of course, we can approximate this F by some linear matrix. But in principle, I mean, using some kind of ideas from deep learning, maybe we can unravel the internal structure of this F function, which in turn will reflect the properties of biological dynamics. So also I would like to mention something which something interesting which is happening in my point of view in application of deep learning ideas into biology is this learning, we can call it learning latent spaces of biological systems. One of the main tools in this direction is these affine encoders, which is a particular architecture of neural networks in which it's a kind of symmetrical architecture consisting of encoding set of layers and decoding set of layers. And you train this neural network such that you try to predict at the output the same signal as in the input in certain sense. There are variations of this idea, but in the middle of this network, you have a narrow layer consisting of a few neurons. And the idea is that by training many modifications of the same kind of representations of the same object, maybe in this narrow layer, you will be able to extract essential features of this object, which are necessary to reconstruct the concept of a cat, for example, in this case. So you can kind of extend this idea to create, to after encoding data from different disjoint data spaces. And this is something which is beyond all this famous application of neural networks to, for example, predicting how you will look in when you will become older. So the basic idea consists in that you have a space of young people faces, you see, have a space of old people faces, and then you create encoders, autoencoders into the same latent space, in which you try to make this distribution of objects from two spaces is as distinguishable as possible using this set of ideas. So generative adversarial networks, optimal transport ideas, or this MD measure. It's all technical details, but the idea is that in the end, what you can do, you can encode an object, for example, from a space of young faces, and then decode it back into the space of older faces. And this is how you translate from one disjoint space to another disjoint space. So in terms of genomic data, you can apply this trick to encode into the same latent space many different modalities, measurements of, for example, similar set of biological objects, individual cells, for example. It can be RNA-seq, it can be ATAC-seq, single cell data, it can be Hi-C data, or it can be also imaging data. And in this recent preprint, there is this exciting demonstration that potentially you can, from knowing the transcriptomic profile, you can predict probable, feasible image of individual single cell and vice versa. I mean, given the image, you can predict let's say the feasible transcriptomic profile. So in my point of view, this is this looks really fantastic, and we will see if it corresponds to reality, these kind of promises of artificial intelligence. So a connected set of ideas is something which is very close to what Kitano suggested in his talk is generative data modeling for systems biology. So on many occasions, you start to use neural networks to predict synthetic transcriptomic, for example, transcriptomic data sets, like in this case. It is tightly connected to the idea of using autoencoders, because in the end, what you do, you use this decoding level to generate feasible transcriptomic profiles, for example, and you sample these transcriptomic profiles in the states of the latent space. So in my vision, we can do many interesting things with this generated data modeling. And but one important question that we start asking or even answering is what are the basic geometry of this latent space? So one of the basic questions, for example, that we can answer is what is the effective dimension of omics measurements? In our group, we have a small working group working on this question using our own set of ideas. But we are not the only one. There are other people which try to answer this question. There are simple formulations of this question. For example, what is the minimal number of genes we need to measure to reconstruct the complete transcriptome or other omics profiles? So a few years ago, it was suggested that 100 random composite measurements are sufficient to reconstruct bulk transcriptomes. And this is certainly an estimation of this dimensionality from above, because these are random linear combinations of genes. So basically what is claimed here is that by measuring randomly chosen 100 linear combination of gene expressions, it's possible to reconstruct the transcriptome. In very recent publication, this 100 number was reduced to 10 when the deep learning approach was applied to similar problems. So the truth probably is somewhere in between this 10 and 100. But in our experiments, also, at least when we look at single cell, it follows that the dimensionality of this intrinsic space is not that enormous. Well, how to look, because 10 dimensional space is still enormous space. I would like to mention this L1000 methodology of the connectivity map project, in which it is suggested to use a set of 1000 genes to reconstruct complete transcriptomic profiles using linear models. So in the end, what they suggest a very inexpensive chip to measure these 1000 genes. And as such, they reconstruct the expression of all 20,000 genes, for example. As such, they managed to generate an astronomical number of transcriptomic profiles, measuring different perturbations to biological systems. And again, deep learning might improve this model. It is shown that when you apply deep learning for the same set of 1,000 landmark genes, you can improve the accuracy of reconstruction of transcriptomic data. I would like to mention an approach which was looked quite intriguing to me. I mean, last year, it's from Kunin's group, in which they trained long short-term memory neural networks for predicting the sequence of mutations in cancer. So they looked at lung and colon cancer, and they tried to train these type of networks in order to be able to simulate afterwards the sequential order of mutations accumulated in a potential tumor. And one of the kind of application of this is that if you know some set of cancer driver genes, which are frequently mutated in these types of cancers, you can also see how they depend also on the mutational history of a given cancer, of a given tumor. So with an idea that all cancer driver genes are conditional and they perform their function given the already accumulated mutational background. So we will see, if this idea will work, but for me, it's clearly one of the promises of artificial intelligence in cancer, for cancer biology. Also, I would like to mention that in bioinformatics and in systems biology, there is a process happening today, already for a few years, which can be called deep renovation of basic tools. For example, in the field of genomic sequence analysis, we have this set of tools created in the last 5 years with a pioneering creation of a deep binder approach, which was supposed to relax this independency assumption, which stays behind application of a positional weight matrix, which is was dominant model for predicting transcription factor binding sites and also predicting motifs in genomic sequences. So it was shown in this tool that you can treat a set of genomic sequences as a set of simple images, 4-pixel-wide images, and then you can apply literally the kitchen, which is identical for in image recognition using deep learning, to construct so-called deep learning model, deep learning based models of transcription factor, for example, binding sites or motifs. Deep variant is another famous tool which used convolutional neural networks to predict genomic variants using neural networks. So using this deep learning based models, you can already predict the effect of certain mutations, like it was demonstrated in this example, where it is shown how individual SNPs or individual point-wise mutations can change promoters of the TERT gene, which is a cancer driver gene, to create a new sites of binding for a particular transcription factor, which can completely rewire the regulation of the TERT gene. So now let us say a few words about what will happen in the future for this couple, AI SB. So will it be a happy aging together, I mean maturing and understanding each other, or it will be, or the interest of the two will diverge at a certain point. And here I would like to remind you this theory of Gartner hype cycle for technological renovations, which states, of course, it's only a model, which states that any technological renovation, or revolution, let's say, in technology, passes through this period of inflated expectations, which is changed by the period of disillusionment, and then it stabilizes. If everything is fine, it stabilizes to some kind of a plateau of productivity, where I mean we have adequate expectations from the technology and so on. So this is a Gartner hype cycle for artificial intelligence and something that I found for biosciences, where systems biology was quite at the peak. I don't know where systems biology is now, but I think it's still quite high, partly thanks to application of artificial intelligence ideas. But what is important to understand is that what drives the technological innovation towards this down from the field. So in case of neural artificial intelligence, these two problems are quite visible today, and they are very much discussed. So the main two critical problems of neural artificial intelligence is that AI sometimes makes bad and unpredictable mistakes. So, I mean, you all heard probably about fragility of neural-based AIs towards adversarial attacks or other types of attacks, which reflects or which is connected to this problem of making mistakes. And we need to develop some a technology which would deal with these mistakes, because apparently this is unavoidable, as nature of, let's say, nature of any intelligence is making mistakes. And another problem of AI, which is kind of largely discussed today, is the problem of explainability. So indeed, it's not satisfactory in many applications of AI have a neural network as a black box. I mean, it's important to rationalize the decisions which are made by the system, and being able to explain to human how this or that decision is done. Just examples of mistakes which are kind of dramatic mistakes of AI that we've heard about. This is a crash of Tesla car in which from investigation, it was shown that the design of AI system was partially responsible for the incident. But what is closer to the topics of our course is this disappointment is in the project of IBM Watson, which invested a huge amount of money and efforts into cancer prediction system based on AI. And in the end, the results were not as inspiring as they looked in the beginning. So you can read about the story if you haven't heard about this. So the main message is that if we don't make specific efforts in this direction to solve and manage these problems of AI, then there is a chance that this new artificial intelligence winter will come. Of course, many applications of artificial intelligence, which are not, let's say, connected to the harm of human health and also some kind of dramatic dramatic mistakes, they will stay. I mean, for example, when we translate from one language to another, we can, in principle, support this kind of mistakes, or we can even make fun of them. But it would be a bit of disappointment if we won't be able to revolutionize the biological research and health system as everybody expects today. For in case of systems biology, there are also critical problems which are far from being solved. I would mention two of them. One of them is the organization of data in systems biology, which is far from being optimal. And when you try to use this data for application of machine learning or other ideas, I mean, it's still, you have this problem of data integration. And also, I think we are still far from approaching modeling a complex large, creating large predictive models in biology. Despite a few examples that I have shown to you, still there is a long way to go. In the field of artificial intelligence, these problems that I have mentioned, they are subject of quite intensive conceptual research. So for example, in this year at the World Congress on Computational Intelligence, Joshua Bengio gave this talk on suggesting the concept of deep learning 2.0, which is based on the idea of systematic generalization. The main motivation of this suggestion is that the human mind is very good in dynamically combining existing concepts, even if new combinations have zero probability at the training distribution. So in other words, the human mind is really good in out of distribution generalization, which is still a problem for most of the AI-based systems. So what Bengio suggests, he suggests to distinguish system one and system two, artificial intelligence solutions. In system one, the system makes decisions which are similar to unconscious, intuitive, and fast human decisions. For example, when we distinguish dog and the cat, we don't think too much. For us, it's almost instantaneous and intuitive decision. And this is how most of the modern neural networks for image recognition work. But in system two, which is a suggestion of this deep learning 2.0, it is suggested to develop more conscious-like and maybe slow solutions, which would manipulate smaller parts of the neural networks corresponding to particular concepts. And so the idea is that such kind of methods will be more explainable to human and will be more useful in the end in certain contexts. So, I mean, I don't know if this should inspire us for thinking about really revising the approach to systems biology and create something which could be called systems biology 2.0. I try to imagine what it can be, but I'm too humble to suggest really the plan of such revision. So it's maybe a source of inspiration for you as a young future researchers. And here I would like to conclude with my talk by saying that machine learning and AI revise what we knew about bioinformatics and systems biology and how we had it, let's say, even 5 years ago. There is these promises of AI to unravel the complexity of biological systems and play the role of translation from biological language to human language. And we probably need to match the advance of systems biology fields to the progress of AI, and all these advances should lead to better understanding of cancer etiology and treatment. So last slide, if you're interested in working on this kind of ideas that I've just mentioned, and you would like to advance the field, there is this nice opportunity, which is Paris Artificial Intelligence Research Institute. It's an institute which was created 1 year ago. And there is a set of researchers here, there, which are interested in these kind of problems, including myself. So there are several postdoc and PhD positions open. If you are interested, please join. This is very exciting opportunity to work in the field between machine learning, artificial intelligence, and biology. And my last word, enjoy the course. I'm pretty sure that it will be useful for you and enlightening, and my best luck for you.